And being Christmas coming up this month, I have a series I'm going to be preaching called Keeping Christ in Christmas. And so we look at that. And while you're turning in your Bibles, I've got a little thing I want to read to you. And it's called this: if the birth of Jesus was covered by today's tabloids, this is what it might say. Illegal alien has illegitimate birth, baby expected to be charged with treason. That would be the headline. And then it says, it was rumored today in Bethlehem an unmarried couple from Nazareth stopped for the use of a manger owned by Alfredo Pinici, a notorious slumlord, and a baby was born there. There was no running water. The place was filled with straw, commented local public health authorities, and we found a donkey inside. The mother gave birth under extremely questionable circumstances, offered Pontius Pilate, the Judean candidate for district attorney. She claims to have been a virgin. And unconfirmed reports indicate that the Roman authorities are investigating the baby on charges of sedition and treason. There are a bunch of people running around alleging that the baby is the Son of God, explained Pilate, and that he will have some radical ideas about religion in the future. Three kings from the Orient were caught on the outskirts of Bethlehem by the Roman border patrol carrying illegal contraband. We caught them red-handed with frankincense and myrrh, explained the official with the border patrol, and they didn't have any papers. The king was promptly arrested and deported back to Syria. At virtually the same time the baby was born, there was a bright star that was sighted over Bethlehem, and they said, this is an omen that things are about to radically change in the empire due to global warming, said the director of the Departmental Protection Agency of the Environment. Well, that may be a tabloid coverage with all its fake and false news narratives going on, but how many glad the Bible tells us what the real story was like? Amen. And so that's what we're going to look to as God's source. Well, like me, you've probably noticed that over the past few years, there seems to be a trend in our society, at least in America, to try to remove Jesus from Christmas. Anybody kind of noticed that? It's just a progressive thing that seems to be going on throughout our society. You know, companies and corporations no longer want to call it a Christmas holiday. They want to take Christ out of the schools. You know, kids can't even say Christmas now in school sometimes without getting, you know, suspended and so forth. You can't sing Christmas songs with Christ in them. They have to be the generic, you know, secular type songs. It's just they're trying to take Christ out of Christmas. So that's what I'm going to be preaching on for the next month, coming off of that idea about keeping Christ in Christmas, at least from our standpoint. What do we as believers need to do to be sure that we keep Christ as the focus of not only Christmas, but how many know he's to be the center of our lives? So that's kind of what I'm going on. So this morning I want to begin with a message specifically about doing God's will. Doing the will of God is the primary way that we will keep Christ in Christmas, that we keep Christ as the center of our lives. Now, of course, in order to be saved, to have eternal life, that means you must come to faith in Christ. But once you are a true believer by faith in Christ, how many know you need to obey the will of God? You got to follow God's will for your life. And that's how we keep Christ as the center of our life and, of course, as the center of Christmas. So let's start reading from verse 18 in Matthew's gospel. It says there, now the birth of Jesus Christ was as follows. After the mother Mary was betrothed to Joseph, before they came together, she was found with child of the Holy Spirit. Then Joseph, her husband, being a just man and not wanting to make her a public example, was minded to put her away secretly. But while he thought about these things, behold, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream, saying, Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to take to you Mary, your wife, for that which is conceived in her is of the Holy Spirit. And she will bring forth a son, and you shall call his name Jesus, for he will save his people from their sins. So all this was done that it might be fulfilled, which was spoken by the Lord through the prophet, saying, behold, the virgin shall be with child, and shall bear a son, and they shall call his name Emmanuel, which is translated God with us. Then Joseph, being aroused from sleep, did as the angel of the Lord commanded him, and took from for him his wife, and did not know her till she had brought forth her firstborn son, and she called his name Jesus. Amen. Wonderful Christmas story there that I want to look at. In that story, you're going to see where Joseph had to obey and do the will of God, something that was very challenging for him at that time. And I'll say this up front, doing God's will is not always easy. But God will give you the strength, because he also says, my burden is easy, my yoke is easy, and my burden is light. Why? Because when you finally choose to do God's will that is difficult sometimes, aren't you glad that God gives us the power, the grace, and the strength to actually do it, and he's there with us. So let's look at this morning and see what it is we need to do in order to do the will of God. The first thing that comes to me out of this story that I believe the Lord stirred in my heart is this. We have to overcome the fear of man. If you want to do God's will, you have to defeat the fear of man, because the fear of man will hinder you from obeying God and doing what God is leading you to do. The fear of man will keep you from doing what God is calling you to do, or that he is showing you he wants you to do for him. The fear of man is a great obstacle that hinders us in our day-to-day lives as we seek to be a witness for the Lord or try just to live for God, because peer pressure comes in from all of the sources to do what they're doing instead of maybe what God wants us to do. So doing God's will requires that. In verse 17, if you actually read that, those first 17 verses, of the Gospel of Matthew are actually about the genealogy of Joseph's family line. And it goes all the way back to Abraham. And it's one of those famous begat chapters when it gives you the lineage. And the purpose for that is Matthew wants to show us that Joseph is descended from Abraham all the way back down even further after him into the line of David. King David was one of the descendants of Abraham, and to David was promised that a king would arise from his lineage to always sit on the throne of David. And so it's important, even though Joseph was not the physical father of Jesus, it was important from a Jewish mindset to show that Joseph was going to be his kind of surrogate father, to be his adopted father, so to speak. It was important that his lineage trace all the way back to King David, so that they could say that Jesus was a legitimate heir to the throne of God and to the line of David. And so that's his purpose in doing that. Joseph discovers, though, in this process, he's engaged to Mary. They're not actually married yet. But in that process of being engaged, he discovers that Mary's pregnant. And that kind of throws a little bit of a trouble into the midst of whatever's happening here. And the child is not physically his. He knows this because they're not together yet. And so he loves her deeply, and so he plans to break off the engagement and put her away secretly, meaning just to make a quiet example of this, instead of a public thing, just to try to do it nicely and bring it to an end there. And as he's contemplating doing this, Matthew tells us that God sends an angel to him in a dream. And the angel speaks to him and tells him not to be afraid to take Mary to be his wife, because the child is not a normal child. This child was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit. God had brought about a miraculous conception, and that was going to be the Son of God that was going to be born there. So what we get from this story, we need to realize that Joseph had a choice here. He loves his wife deeply, but at the same time, he knows what people are going to say, what people are going to think, because they're engaged, but she's pregnant. And in their society, that was a terrible thing for them to face. But yet he has this dream where he knows it's from God, and he has a choice to make. Do I obey God, or do I do what I want to do? And so that's where I get this first principle. If you're going to obey the will of God, you have to defeat and overcome the fear of man. Because it was the fear of man and what other people would be saying and thinking that was the obstacle that Joseph had to face. And I will tell you tonight, or this morning, if you and I are to do God's will, we have to deal with that fear of man ourselves. We have to say, God, I'm going to obey you despite what other people think, say, or whatever. That is a key point in all of this. Because what other people, what they do is their business, but how do you know what we do? That's what's important. I got a little Ziggy comic that illustrates this point I want to bring up to you. Ziggy's reading a book that says, I'm okay, you're okay, but everybody else is out to get us. You ever thought about that? You ever think like that sometimes? So, everybody seems to be out to get us. That fear of man and what they're going to, what's going on out there. And that is a thing that hinders us so many times. So let me just define this for a few moments. What is the fear of man? And I've got a PowerPoint that illustrates this. Let's talk about this for a few moments. What is the fear of man? Well, there are three main things that constitute the fear of man. First of all, it's this. Bring up the first one. It's a fear of what other people think of us. Because we want people to like us. We want people to think well of us. That's a natural human trait. And so the fear of man, first of all, is basically a fear of what people may be thinking about us. Because we don't know what's going on in their head unless you have powers or something like that. But most of us, if you're normal, you want other people to think good of you. You want them to think well of you. You want them to have a good idea about you. And so the fear of man, first of all, is a fear of what people will be thinking. And so because we're afraid of what people might think about us, that decides quite often what we do and what we don't do. And how many know you have to do what God wants you to do and obey God despite what other people might think? If they think you're crazy, that's fine. Paul said, I'll be a fool for Christ if necessary. You see, we have to obey God despite what other people think. The second thing that it includes is a fear of what people may say about us. Because, you know, when people think something, that's bad. But when they go out and say it, either to us directly or go around talking about us behind our backs. How many know we're afraid of that quite often? You know, people are people, but some people are stupid. Have you ever noticed that? Some people are nice, and some people are meaner than a Texas rattlesnake. And they like to gossip. They like to say everything. They like to talk about you behind your back. Oh, they'll be nice and sweet and have a smile on their face when they're talking to you. But the moment you leave, they're on their phone, they're texting, or they're talking to someone, and they are just taking you to the dump. And we're afraid of what people will not only think about us, but what they're saying about us. Well, honey, you have to obey God, no matter what other people say. And sometimes you cannot defend yourself. You just have to do what God's called you to do and trust that God will be the one that will vindicate you. And let me tell you something. There are numerous times in the Psalms where David prays and he knows that people are saying things about him and doing things to him. And he knows that he can't fight that. You can't fight what people are saying and thinking. So you know what he prays? He says, God, be my vindicator. Vindicate me, defend me. And in the end, people saw his righteousness come forth. Because how many know that God will defend you in the long run? Yeah, you know, people may say and think and do things in a short term, but ultimately, how many know the truth comes out? And even if you have made a mistake, the good news is, if you will remain faithful to God and humble yourself, God will promote you, and then in the end, people will see you're still the person that God created you to be. See, that's what we have to trust in. You have to defeat that fear of what people will say about you. Then thirdly, it carries an idea of what you're afraid of what people might actually do. You know, it's bad enough if they think it, and it's worse if they say it, but there are some people that might actually do something to hurt you physically or take action against you on your job. I don't know, there are times where Christians on a job sometimes will be persecuted by their boss, their employer, or even other employees who manipulate you to kind of get them in trouble because they don't like the way you do your job, or they don't like you because you're a Christian. They don't like you witnessing or talking about that Jesus. They don't like to see the Bible laying on your desk or whatever. And so there are times where people might actually do something to come against you. We have to fear God more than we fear man. We have to say, God, I'm going to obey you. Whatever you're leading me to do, whatever your word tells me to do, I'm going to do that because that's what you call me to. Proverbs 29, verse 25 is a verse I want to read that simply says this: the fear of man brings a snare, but whoever trusts in the Lord shall be safe. If you give in to that fear of man, it's going to bring a trap in your life and it'll snare you down. But if you will trust in God, how many are glad that God will preserve you, God will watch over you, and God will bring you through? So keep your faith and trust in him. That fear of man comes from a desire to be in your own boss, to be in control of everything. And the approval of others is what we're looking for, but you need God's approval more than the approval of other people. What other people think about us, it makes us feel sometimes bad or rejected, and nobody likes feeling rejected. But I've said it before, you need to reject the rejection and thank God, because your self-worth comes from him. Amen. And who he is in Christ and who you are in Jesus. Alvin C. York made this quote. He's the most highly decorated soldier of World War I. My favorite movie is made by him. You can come see it with me sometime. I even got the DVD. He said this: the fear of God makes a hero. The fear of man makes a coward. See, he could say that because in World War I, he did not want to go and enlist when they called him up for the draft because he was a conscientious objector. He said, I can't fight. I can't kill. He said he thought that was wrong biblically, but he still went. And in the midst of this battle where all of his soldiers are being machine gunned all around him, he was a corporal because he was the sharpshooter. He was the best shooter in the entire army. I mean, this guy it was just incredible what he could do. And so they promoted him to corporal, even though they weren't sure he would shoot anybody. And so as his whole unit is being wiped out by machine guns, he takes action and he personally kills 25 German soldiers and captures 132 single-handedly. God was with him. And he gives credit to God because he became a Christian earlier in his life. It's a powerful movie. I encourage you to go rent it somewhere. Well, you probably can't even rent it. It's hard to find nowadays. But it's a beautiful movie. And he said this, the fear of God is what makes you a hero. You can't let the fear of man and what man will do to you keep you from doing God's will. The second principle that comes out of this about doing God's will that goes beyond just dealing with the fear of man is this. We have to recognize what God is doing. I mean, you're glad that God is working and doing things. He didn't just create everything and then just go sit on his throne and just kind of leave it all alone. You know, God is still active. God is still moving. God is still working. The word says he sustains and upholds all things by his own word of his power. I mean, you're glad that God's holding everything together. You know, scientists can't figure out why you are the way you are. They look at the science of gravity and so forth, but technically, if they're honest, there is no reason why you should keep the shape and the form that you have. I mean, literally, you should just fly off. Your electrons and your protons and your neutrons, you know, they should just be pulled and going everywhere. But the Bible says it simply, it's the power of God ultimately that holds all things together and sustains all things. Now, he created some principles and laws in nature and science that keep it going after that, but how do you know that God is the one that keeps this thing all together? So we have to recognize what God is doing. Joseph, his engagement, you have to understand, was legally binding. Their engagements are a little bit different than what we have today. When a Jewish person was engaged, they were treated as if you were married, even though the marriage had not been finalized. So in order to actually end an engagement, you had to get a bill of divorcement. So it was a serious thing in their time. And so it required a divorce, and that's what he intended to do. But here God speaks to him, and the angel Lord tells him in a dream and reveals the truth about what is happening with Mary, that Mary is carrying a child that's conceived by the Holy Spirit. Now, let me tell you something. Let's be honest. If you had been in Joseph's shoes and you hear that, that sounds like a whopper. That sounds like, wow, really? And yet he believes it. He accepts it because the angel of the Lord that appeared to him in a dream, it was so real and so overpowering that he knew that. Of course, Mary has told him this, and he knows her integrity, and he knows her. And so he receives this as a confirmation that this is God that is speaking to him. That grounds of belief and faith that Joseph had, let me tell you something, it's the same type of faith that we have to have today. See, people in the world today scoff and mock at what the Bible calls and talks about the miraculous conception and birth of Jesus, but we know the Bible tells us that because it is the way it is. Matter of fact, if you study ancient mythologies of the pagans and the religions of their day, it was a popular concept that the gods would come down and have children with human women. That was a common thing. Those of you who come on Wednesday nights from studies over the past year and a half, you know that's a well-rounded thing. Even the Bible talks about it, but they weren't gods. They were fallen angels that came down in Genesis chapter 6. And so this concept was not a new thing that the gods could have children, but the way God did it was totally different. Because, I can just be blunt, you know, we don't like to talk about sex in church, but there was no sex involved. The Holy Spirit supernaturally created the life within Mary's womb. And that was the difference. That was what was different about this. That's what set the miraculous birth of Christ apart from the miraculous birth of all the other, what the fallen angels had done. It was totally different, and the Gospels emphasize that point. We don't get that reading it in English and not understanding the backdrop of the pagan mythology and what was going on today and the way that it always happened like that. We don't get that, but understand that's what it is. And the Gospels is directly contrasting what God did with the power of the Holy Spirit versus what was going on in the prior history of the world. Aren't you glad that our God is greater and bigger than anything the enemy or the devil or any evil power of darkness can try to do? Well, Matthew goes on to tell us in verses 22 and 23 that what happened here is a fulfillment of prophecy. It was a prophecy by Isaiah in chapter 7, verse 14. And Isaiah 7:14 simply says this, "Therefore the Lord himself shall give you a sign. Behold, a virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and you shall call his name Emmanuel." And how many know what Emmanuel means? God with us. God is with us. God is now with us. What a beautiful promise that through the birth of Jesus, this little baby who would grow into be a man, not just a normal human being, but the God-man, the Word of God made flesh, God would now be with humanity. He would be with every single person. And even though they didn't fully understand everything, and Joseph didn't fully understand everything, I don't think he could have. I think, though, he still had a simple faith that took God at his word. And despite the challenges and all the difficulties that he was going to face, he believed God and obeyed God and did what God wanted. Why? Because he understood, at least to a limited degree, and saw what God was doing. And that's why I want to tell you, if you want to do God's will, you have to recognize what God is doing. If you miss the boat, how many know you ain't getting on it? All right? I'll tell you, I may have shared this with you. I've been here 9 years, so sometimes I forget what stories I've shared before. But I had a chance when I was a teenager with my mom. My mom sold jewelry on the side, and she sold enough jewelry. Man, she was a good jewelry seller. She sold enough jewelry through Park Lane Jewels. There she won a trip for two to Hollywood. All expenses paid. And we were going to be on The Price is Right in the audience. I had the price. I watched that show for months. I had a little notepad. I took down the exact price of every single thing on there. I had it alphabetized. Anything they called out that Bob Barker did, I could tell you to the penny what that was. Because if my mom got on that show, I was going to shout out the exact price and we were going to win the big one. I'm serious. I had it down. You know, I read a story where last year somebody did what I did and went and won the big prize. And they tried to disqualify him. He said, you can't disqualify me. I just watched your show and wrote down everything and then memorized it or had somebody in the audience shout it out to him, because you can shout out from the audience whatever it was. They took my idea and won. But you know why we didn't get to go there? Because my mom had the wrong day down on the calendar and we missed the plane. And so instead we got a complimentary trip to Acapulco. Yay, hey. Reason I'm saying hey, hey is because we got sick as a dog and spent most of the trip in the hotel room. You can't be on the boat if you miss it. So you have to recognize what God is doing and then jump in and get involved with it. And so that's an important thing there. You know, too many times people are looking for the way out, the way to circumvent. You know, you need to just do what God wants. Recognize what God is doing. Instead of taking the easy way out. D.L. Moody, a famous pastor minister, once said this: obedience means marching right on whether we feel like it or not. Many times we go against our feelings. Faith is one thing, feeling is another. That's a powerful statement. You can follow your feelings, and how many know your feelings come and go and they change like the wind? And if you live by your feelings, you're going to always be defeated. But if despite what you feel, you take the word of God and you stand on the promises of God and say, I believe the promises of God, and you pray that way and you stand in faith, then you can obey God because you'll recognize what God is doing. And God will take you and work through you and do powerful things. But if you follow your feelings, and some of us have really fickle feelings, I don't feel like, I had a cold earlier this week. You know, I'm still overcoming the lack of sleep. You know that happens when that. So this morning, I'll be honest with you. When I woke up, I did not feel like coming to church. I wanted to lay in bed and attend Badside Baptist. I wanted to hear Pastor Pillow preach in my dreams. But you can't do that, can you, Brother James? You gotta go and make a joyful noise unto the Lord. You gotta praise God. It's gotta be a choice and say, I'm going to rejoice in the Lord my God, whether I feel like it or not. And I'll tell you something, when you make that choice and you begin to praise God and you do God's will, aren't you amazed at how suddenly the Spirit of God begins to move on you and to empower you and strengthen you, to heal you, to deliver you, to give you the joy, the peace, and what you didn't feel before, I think you might start feeling. But even if you don't, you still sometimes have to do something by faith, because we walk by faith, not by sight. Not by sight. We have to recognize what God is doing, or we'll never actually accomplish God's will for our life. The third point I want to bring out is simply this. Not only do you need to overcome the fear of man, and not only do you need to recognize what God is doing, but you also have to simply obey God's word. Doing God's will means I've got to obey his word. What does God tell me to do? I've got to be willing to do it. When Joseph awoke from that dream, Matthew tells us that he did as the angel of the Lord commanded him in that dream. He took Mary to be his wife, but they didn't come together as husband and wife until after the child had been born. He had to overcome that fear of man by choosing to obey God's word, what God had said to him, what God had spoken to him, despite what other people said, thought, felt, or even did. You know, sometimes if you're going to do God's will and obey his word, it will require a sacrifice. It will require a sacrifice. It takes courage just to obey God despite what other people will say or think, what your friends might say or think. Some of your neighbors think you're crazy anyway because they see you come to church all the time, and, you know, they don't do that. Just be a fool for Christ. Let them know whose side you're on. I remember a story about an old man who was half blind and couldn't hear nothing hardly at all, and, you know, he would walk to church because the church was only a couple blocks from his home every Sunday, and one of his neighbors who was an atheist was just mocking him every Sunday and making fun of him, and he finally yelled at him as he walked by one morning and said, "Hey, you old fool, you can't see what's going on, you can't hear what they're saying in there, why do you bother going?" And he yelled back, because actually he must have heard him that time, he said, "I want him to know whose side I'm on." Make a stand. Make a stand. Doing God's will. Charles Spurgeon once said this. He said, "Faith and obedience are bound up in the same bundle. He that obeys God trusts God, and he that trusts God obeys God." If I'm going to obey God, I've got to trust him. And if I'm going to trust him, then I will do what God wants. I will obey my God. Because I know God has everything working according to his plan, and he will bless me as a result of that. You know, we need to please God above everything else. So let that be the desire of our heart. Let the Holy Spirit lead and direct you, because as you let the Spirit of God lead and direct you, you'll be walking in the Spirit, because that's how the Bible tells us that we obey God. We let the Spirit of God lead us, and as we follow the leading of the Holy Spirit, he will lead us, and we can overcome and do what God wants, because we'll walk in the Spirit, and that means I'm yielded to God. I'm yielded to God. I'm not doing what I want. I'm doing what God wants. A minister named Terry Fulham once said this: "The fruit of the Spirit grows only in the garden of obedience." We all know what the fruit of the Spirit is. Paul talks about the fruit of the Spirit: love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, kindness, faith, meekness, temperance. The fruit of the Spirit, it develops, though, in that garden of obedience. When I obey God, the fruit of the Spirit works inside of me. Paul said it this way in Ephesians chapter 5, verses 1 and 2. He simplified it and he said, "Be an imitator of God, dear children, and walk in love as Christ has loved us and given himself for us, an offering and a sacrifice to God for a sweet-smelling aroma." Be an imitator of God and then walk in love. See, that's how I obey God's word. Whatever he says when I read it, I am willing to do that. But then also what his Spirit leads me to do, because, you know, as you go through your day-to-day life, the Spirit of God will lead and direct you. And if you're sensitive to that and recognize that and obey that, you're doing God's will in that process. We have to do what Joseph did in verse 25. He had to obey God. When that child was born, God told him, "You name that child Jesus." And he did. He named the child Jesus. You know what the Hebrew word for Jesus is? It's Yeshua. And Yeshua, I've got a PowerPoint, it simply means God saves. God saves. Yeshua means God saves. Why? Because the angel said he's going to save his people from their sins. Aren't you glad that Yeshua is the one who saves us from our sins? Our sins separated us from God. Our sins were going to condemn us forever to an eternity separated from him. But Yeshua, Jesus, came in order to save us from our sins. It was the plan of God from the beginning. When Joseph held that baby boy when he was first born in his arms, looked in his eyes, I wonder what he was thinking. But he was beholding the very Son of God, the future Savior of all mankind. That was God's plan from the beginning. He planned it all that way, even before the foundation of the world. That was what God intended. He wanted to save you and I through what Jesus did. So if we want to keep Christ as the center of our lives and keep Christ in Christmas, then we've got to do God's will. How do we do God's will? Overcome that fear of man. Recognize what God is doing in your life and obey him. If you'll do this, you'll do God's will, and Christ will be glorified. Because maybe this Christmas, let's seek and plan to glorify Jesus above all else. Despite all the gifts and all the hassles and all the busyness that comes with the holidays, we need to glorify Jesus. Amen. Lift him up and exalt him. Let God be magnified. Amen. Would you pray with me this morning?